Haggai chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. In the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, in the first day of the month, came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet unto Zerubbabel the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua the son of Josedech the high priest, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, This people say, The time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, Is it time for you, O you, to dwell in your silly houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, Consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourself, but there is none warm. And he that earns wages to put into a bag with holes. Thus saith the Lord once again, Consider your ways. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord of hosts. After 70 years in Babylonian captivity, Israel, some 50,000 Jews, returned back to Jerusalem with the command given by the king, and really the command given by the Lord, to go back into Jerusalem, now set free from captivity, to go back into Jerusalem and to begin to lay the foundation of the temple of the Lord. The temple of the Lord signifying the presence of God being with Israel. And they come back to Jerusalem and they begin to build the temple of the Lord. They begin to do what God had instructed, what the king had allowed them to do, knowing that the presence of God was their only hope. They begin to institute the sacrifice. They begin to lay the foundation. But somewhere along the way, men of God, so-called, came in and said, Well, this will never be like it used to be. We saw the temple in Solomon's day when it was full of glory and full of might and full of jewels and gold and silver. This will never be what it once was. And not only were these so-called religious leaders opposing the work of God, but there were outward forces, types of the enemy coming and opposing the very work of God that had been instituted by God himself, that they would come back to Jerusalem after being set free from captivity, that they would come back and they would begin to do the work of the Lord, that they would begin to lay the foundation of the temple of the world of the Lord. Somewhere along the way, fear, complacency, discouragement all crept in, and for some 16 years, they ceased to do the work of the Lord. For some 16 years after the command had been given to them, because of outward opposition, because of unbelief, and because of complacency, they had ceased to do the work of the Lord. And the work of the Lord was simply, build me a temple so that my presence can abide with you.
Amen.
That was the command. That was the instruction. But because of complacency, because of fear, and because of unbelief, the work of the Lord had stopped. And in 520 BC, somewhere around that area, God raises up two young prophets full of the Spirit of God to come to Israel and to command them to consider their ways. To consider what you're doing. Consider what's going on. Have I told you to stop doing what I first commanded you to do? And not only did he command them to consider their ways, but he encouraged them that if they would come back to the foundation that was already laid, that he, by the power of the Holy Spirit, would help them to accomplish the work that he desired to be accomplished in that time and in that hour.
Amen.
And I say to you, I know this because I feel the Holy Spirit has been impressing it upon my own heart and my own life. But I say to you that I believe that the Holy Spirit, in the time and hour in which we are living, I believe this. I believe God has spoken this to me. I believe God has told me that wherever I go, to tell the people to consider your ways. Where are you? What are you doing? What is the focus of your life? What is the focus of your ministry? What is the focus of your very life and of your very living? For 16 years, they were worried about their own houses, worried about their own needs, worried about their own this and their own that, that they negated, they neglected the work of the Lord. I ask you today, are you negating, are you neglecting the work of the Holy Spirit, the work of the Lord that ought to be, that should be, that must be taking place in your heart and in your life? God had said that the days to come would be filled with more glory than there was glory before. But that was only if they would return to God's way. And maybe all of us here tonight are doing it perfectly, I don't know. But I do believe this, that the Holy Spirit is asking the church, He is telling the church, consider your ways. Consider your ways. And that's the message I want to preach tonight. Consider your ways. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this opportunity that You've given us, Lord, to proclaim Your word. Father, we thank You for these people, Lord God, that sit with us tonight. Father God, we thank You for each and every one of them. Father, we ask that You would, Lord, send Your Spirit in this place. Father, that You would anoint my mind and anoint my heart, Lord. For without the Holy Spirit, Lord, I can do nothing. For it's the Holy Spirit, O God, that is the true preacher and the true teacher, Lord. It's only the power of the Holy Spirit that can affect changes, Lord, in the hearts and lives of Your people, Father. So tonight we ask for the help of the Holy Spirit to deliver this word that I believe that You have placed upon my heart. Father, I ask that You would anoint us, Lord God, to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. And Father, when it's all said and done, as we do now, we'll be sure to give You the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said amen.
Amen.
And amen. So in 536 BC, or somewhere around that time, as I said just a moment ago, Jerusalem being set free from Babylonian captivity, some 50,000 Jews come back to Jerusalem with the command from the king, but not only the king, I believe, especially from the Lord, to come back and to begin to lay the foundation of the temple. Because it was the temple of the Lord that I said a moment ago. It was that which signified, it was that which provided with them the presence of God, the leading and the guiding and the moving and the operation of God's Spirit among their people. When they first come back into Jerusalem, you can read this in the book of Ezra, chapter 1 through chapter 7. You can read the whole account of them coming back to Jerusalem. But when they first come back to Jerusalem, they set up the institution of the sacrifice once again. The Bible tells us in Ezra chapter 3 that they set up the institution of the sacrifice for fear of the opposing nations, the opposing people who were around them. So that tells me something, that the young generation, that they knew that the sacrifice is what would keep them, that the sacrifice is what would protect them. They instituted the sacrifice because they were fearful of the opposing forces that were on the outside. They were fearful of that which would oppose the work of God. So they knew that if we institute the sacrifice, they knew that if we raise up the altar, they knew that if we hold fast to the sacrifice of the Lamb, that we will have God's favor and we will have God's protection. That no matter what we do from here on out, if we'll just stay true to the sacrifice, if everything we do will be in order, will be after, will be by, will be through the sacrifice, then we'll have God's favor, we'll have God's protection. So they come back into Jerusalem. They're excited about what God is going to do. They're excited about coming into Jerusalem and laying the foundation of the temple, building the temple of the Lord. They were excited, this young generation. They come back. The young generation, all they've known their whole life is captivity. Born into captivity, raised in captivity. That's all they've known their whole life, is being in captivity under the rule of heathen monarchs and heathen kings. And even though they were still not their own nation, even though they were still under heathen rule and heathen monarchs, even though they were set free to do the work of the Lord, they were set free to do as they pleased. This young generation had never experienced this before. There was such a freedom and such a joy and such a power that they had never known before. They never knew in their entire lifetime, from the time they were born, from all throughout being raised to the time of their adulthood, they never knew what it was to have the freedom to do what God was asking them to do. So they come back into Jerusalem. They're excited about the work of God. They're excited about what God is asking them to do. They institute the sacrifice. And that tells us that some kind of way there were still fathers who were true to the Lord. There were still fathers in the faith who were true. They knew the way of God. They knew that without the sacrifice that Israel would be nothing. They knew that without the temple they wouldn't have the presence and the power of Almighty God. This young generation, they've been taught that. So in Ezra chapter 3 we see them come back into Jerusalem and really they have a church service. They institute the sacrifice. They begin to lay the foundation. It takes them about 2 years to lay the foundation of the temple of the Lord. It takes them about 2 years. And after the foundation was laid, the Bible says that they began to rejoice, that they began to shout with great triumph. They began to shout with great joy, and they began to sing unto the Lord that He is great and greatly to be praised, that He is a great God and His mercies endure forever. But in the midst of their joy, in the midst of their shout, in the midst of their rejoicing, there were those fathers who, like I said a moment ago, who sat back with their arms crossed, mad at what was going on, because they said, "We saw Solomon's temple, and this temple will never be like it was in the days of old. This will never amount to anything because it won't be filled with the Shekinah glory. It won't have the jewels and the precious stones and the gold and the silver. It won't have what we saw in our day." And the Bible tells us in Ezra chapter 3 that the noise was so great between the shout and between the weeping that the people who stood afar off could not tell whether Israel was rejoicing or whether they were sad. Because one group of people were excited about what God was doing in the time and hour. They were excited about following the will of God. They were excited about following the ways of the Lord. But yet the religious sect, the religious group of that day, the so-called hierarchy, the so-called fathers, they were upset because they were not the ones called to do the work. They were upset because this will never be like it was in the days of old. So some rejoiced, while many wept. Some rejoiced, many wept when the foundation, because they seen this was a step closer. This when the foundation was finished, when the foundation was complete, this was a step closer to the temple of the Lord being built and being instituted. This was a step closer to following the way of the Lord. This was a step closer to doing what God is asking us to do. But somewhere along the way, after those 2 years of laying the foundation of the Lord, somewhere along the way, the fathers had an influence. The older generation, those who doubted, those who murmured, those who complained, they had an influence on that younger generation. They had an influence filling their hearts with doubt and with unbelief. And not only that, but there came a decree from the heathen king that the work of the temple, that the work of the Lord was to cease. So after laying the foundation with great joy, after rejoicing because the sacrifice had been instituted, after being joyous over what God was going to do in Israel, the work of the Lord ceased. It ceased because, number one, their complacency. You read that in Haggai chapter 1, that they were worried about their own needs. They were worried about their own situations. They were worried about what was going on in their hearts and in their lives. The Lord would say, "You think it's okay that you're dwelling in your houses that are well off and that are rich looking, and you're just focusing on your life and what you want to do? You think that's okay, Israel?" So complacency had filled their hearts. Somewhere along the way, in some 16 years, complacency had filled their hearts. And not only complacency, but fear had begun to creep in. They became fearful of the outward opposition that was at hand. They had started off right. They had started off in joy. They had started off in strength. But somewhere along the way, the enemy had sway over them. And just like Satan did in the Garden of Eden, Satan came and said, "Did God really say for you to do this thing? Did God really say for you to build this temple? Did God really tell you to institute the sacrifice? Did He really tell you to lay the foundation of the temple of the Lord?" That's the same opposition that we're facing today. It's the question that Satan has been asking from the beginning of time. Has God really said? Has God really told you to go the way of the sacrifice? Has God really told you to focus on the work of the Lord? Has God really told you to do thus and so? Has He really told you to place your faith in Christ and what He's done at the cross? Paul would say in 2 Corinthians 11, he would say, and I talked about this this morning in John's church, that I'm scared for you that your minds would be corrupted from the simplicity that is in the gospel, that just as the serpent beguiled Eve, just as the serpent tempted and deceived Eve, so that he would deceive you and beguile your minds from the simplicity that is in Christ. So Satan, somewhere along the way, and it was through the heathen monarchs, through the heathen king, that he commanded that the work of the Lord would cease. So fear began to grip their hearts because of the opposition at hand. Because of the outward opposition, fear began to creep into their hearts and they ceased to do the work of the Lord. And not only complacency and fear, but unbelief began to enter. Because the fathers, at the laying of the foundation, the fathers at the instituting of the sacrifice, they were crying out, "This will never be like it used to be." And let me tell you something, unbelief is a contagious thing. Unbelief is contagious, just as faith is contagious. Unbelief is contagious. You better recognize and you better know who you're surrounding yourself with. If you're surrounding yourself with people who say, "Well, I really don't know if it's all about that message of the cross. I really don't know if it's really all about Christ and Him. I really don't know." Eventually, your mind and your heart is going to be swayed from the work of the Lord. It's going to be moved from what God intends for your mind and your heart to be settled on. So the fathers, the unbelieving religious leaders of that day, eventually had an influence on the younger generation who was once zealous, who was once excited, who was once rejoicing and joyous over the work of God that was going on in Israel. You've got to understand, these people were excited. They were rejoicing. They had never experienced freedom to do the work of the Lord like they had now. They were zealous to do for God. They were zealous to believe God. But because of complacency, because of fear, because of unbelief, for some 16 years, they ceased to do the work of the Lord. For some 16 years, they walk away from the very purpose and the very plan of God. Now we can argue, well, you know, it was meant to be that way, or God wanted it to be that way. But the implication in Scripture is that even though there were outward opposing forces, even though there were unbelieving religious fathers, the implication is that the building was never to cease. Because when God raises up Haggai and Zechariah, He doesn't come on the scene and say, "Hey guys, you're doing a good job." He comes on the scene and He says, "Israel, are you not saying that it's not time to do the work of the Lord? Are you still sitting here saying that it's not time to build the house of the Lord? Are you still sitting here trying to make a decision as to whether or not you're going to do the work that I've called you to do or not? Are you still sitting here waiting to make a decision? I've already given you the command. I've given you the material. I've given you the power. Now go forth and do the work of the Lord." When we're given much, we are required of much. Don't think that you can just be revealed the truth of this gospel and not do anything with it. When you're revealed truth, God expects you to take that truth and apply it to your everyday life and living. He expects you to do something with that which He reveals to you and that which He gives you. He had already given the commandment. But the implication is they were waiting for some manifestation of some sorts. They were waiting for outward opposition to completely stop. They were just sitting around waiting for something to happen. It's like the church today. We're sitting around, we're searching for, we're looking for, we're waiting for manifestations all over the place when the ultimate manifestation has already been given to us. The manifestation of the Son of the Living God.
Amen.
So when God raises up Haggai and Zechariah, he's not asking much of them. He's just telling them, go back to doing the work of the Lord. Consider your ways. And I believe that's what the Holy Spirit is crying to the church today. Consider your ways. Because the Holy Spirit is speaking to the church in the time and hour in which we are living. The Holy Spirit is speaking to the church whether you realize it or not. You ask me, what is he speaking? Just get in the Word of God and you'll see what the Holy Spirit is trying to say to the church. You can hear what the Holy Spirit is trying to say to the church. The Holy Spirit raises up Haggai and Zechariah to tell the people, you don't have to go and build a new foundation. You don't have to go and institute a new sacrifice. You don't have to go and do all that. Just go back to the foundation that has already been laid. Go back to the foundation that has already been finished, that has already been laid. That's all I'm asking you to do, is to go back to the foundation and begin to build the house of the Lord. That's all he was asking of Israel to do. That's all the Holy Spirit today is asking the church to do, is to come back to the foundation of the Lord. Come back to the foundation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm thankful for preachers and ministries and all these things that we do and that we get involved in. But if we're not building upon the foundation of Jesus Christ and what he's done at the cross, if we're not returning back to that foundation that has already been laid, then we are living our lives, whether we know it or not, we are living our lives under a curse. Paul said, if any man come unto you preaching any other gospel, then let him be accursed. What Paul was saying is the gospel I'm preaching, it's not new. It's not something that I made up in my own mind and in my own heart. This is the gospel that was formulated in the mind of God from before the foundation of the world. So I'm not asking you to go out and build a denomination or a church. I'm just telling you, you've got to return back to the foundation of your faith.
Amen.
And that was what the Holy Spirit was telling Israel in the time and hour of which we're speaking. Typology, but he was telling them, get back to the foundation of the temple of the Lord. They had spent 16 years of their life literally under a curse. The Lord said, everything you do has been cursed. The Lord was pretty much saying, everything that your hands touch have been cursed. The very ground that you walk on has been cursed. You sow much, but you reap little. Those who earn wages, they have holes in their pockets. And the wages fall straight through their pockets to the ground, and they never see that for which they worked for. The church today, we're working and we're doing, and we don't even realize it, but the church as a whole is living under a delusion. They're living under a curse because they've left the work of the Lord. They've left the foundation of the Lord that has already been laid. And I'm not saying that's you tonight. I'm saying that we better be careful, that we better be diligent. We better be sober. We better have our minds and our eyes open by the power of the Holy Spirit, because there's great deception in the land. And the enemy is ever striving, he's ever trying to pull us away from the work of the Lord, to pull us away from the simplicity of the gospel that is Jesus Christ and what he's done at the cross. The Lord was not asking Israel to go and to build a new foundation. He was just asking them to return to the foundation that had already been laid. But for 16 years, because they wouldn't return to the foundation, for 16 years, 14, 15, 16 years, they lived their lives under a curse. They struggled and they fought and they battled just to live.
They struggled and they fought and they battled just to build their own homes. They struggled, they fought and they battled just to harvest their own grain, just to do their own thing. They struggled and fought and battled. All the while, if they would have continued the work of the Lord, they would have had the help, the provision, and the blessings of Almighty God. Because the temple, when it was started, it was instituted according by through the sacrifice. They had the help of the Lord to begin. They had the help of the Lord to start. They had the help of the Lord, the provision of God. They had the power of God. But when they left the work of the Lord, when they left the foundation that has been laid, God's hand was then removed off of them. God's hand was then pulled back from their hearts and from their lives. God's provision was then pulled back because they left the very thing. They left the very work of God that He was trying to do in the time and in the hour in which they were living. They left the very thing that provided them with the presence of Almighty God. And I'm afraid today that's what the church is doing. We're leaving the very thing that provides us with the help, with the presence, with the provision of Almighty God. It's the foundation. Paul said, no other foundation can any man lay than the foundation that has already been laid. No other foundation can any man lay. And because they had left the foundation, because they had ceased to work, do the work of the Lord, God's Spirit was then pulled back and left them to their own devices, to do as they please, to work according to their own power. So for 16 years, they lived their lives without the help, without the aid, without the power of God's Spirit moving and operating in their midst. There was really no excuse, the implication that there is no excuse for them not to build. The fathers of old, they sat back and they said, well, this will never be like it used to be because we don't have the gold, we don't have the silver, we don't have the precious jewels and stones to make it like it used to be. But the promise had been given that the glory of the latter house would be greater than that of the former. It would be greater than that of the former. So their excuse in saying, we don't have the materials like Solomon's temple, the Lord responded and said, go up into the mountains and get trees. Go up into the woods and get bushes and branches and trees and come back to the temple and begin to build the temple of the Lord. That's what his response was. So he was telling them, you have no excuse to tell me that you don't have material. The Lord was saying, I don't care what it looks like on the outward. I'm just worried about my presence being able to dwell in your midst. I don't care what it looks like on the outward. Just give me what you got and I will work with what you give me. And that's the same thing the Spirit of God is telling us today. He's not worrying about us looking like we used to look, or looking like our fathers looked, or looking like the church in the early 1900s looked, or the 18 or the 7. He's not worried about all that. All the outward foolishness that we worry about and that we focus on so many times. We get caught up in all that, that if God's going to do something in me, then I've got to provide Him with something special. He's telling us, just provide me with yourself. Provide me with a temple and I'll inhabit the temple that you give me. Amen. I'll inhabit the tabernacle that you give me. Just go up to the mountain, get some wood, get whatever you got, present it to me, and I'll accompany you with my power and with my glory. Amen. They didn't need all the fancy and all the good looking things that they thought in their mind that they needed. He was just saying, go get wood and bring it to the foundation and I'll send my power, I'll send my glory. And really the reason for which the glory of the latter house would be greater than that of the former, because some 400 or 500 years later, the Messiah himself, the one whom God had spoke of, whom God had prophesied about for some 4,000 years, would make his way into Jerusalem, would inhabit the place of Jerusalem. And it would be a glory unlike Israel had never known and had never seen before. It may not have been a glory like they desired or like they wanted, like they had in Solomon's temple. But it was a glory that God sent. It was the Savior of mankind whom would inhabit Jerusalem.
Amen.
So God, through Haggai and Zechariah, He begins to address the issues. Just like He comes and addresses our issues, He asks us to consider our ways. Why have we walked away from the foundation of the Lord? Because we can be doing all the good things in our lives. We can be doing all the good things in our churches and for our ministries and everything else. But in our own personal hearts, in our own personal life and living, if we've left the foundation of our faith, if we've taken that and we've tried to build upon another foundation, it'll be like Jesus said in the parable of the houses when He said that you'll build on other things, but they'll be just like sinking sand. The weather will come, the things, the storms of this life will come, and they'll simply blow them away. But when you build your hope, like the old song says, when you build your hope on things eternal, you can have the blessings and the power of God accompanying your life. So in our personal life and living, we can be doing all the right things outwardly or seemingly doing all the right things and even seemingly prospering in our lives. Seemingly prospering in what we're doing, seemingly prospering in that which we're putting our labor to. But in our hearts, in our lives, if we've left the foundation, if we've left the foundation of our faith, which is Christ and Him crucified, and I know this is simple, but I believe this is what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church. Because if we leave that foundation, there's no telling what we'll wind up doing. There's no telling where we will end up. There's no telling how far from the work of the Lord that we will end up if we leave the foundation, the simple foundation of our faith. I'm seeing it over and over again. I'm seeing it time and time again. Israel, they were excited about what God was doing when they first came out of captivity. Just like you and I, we get it when the Lord first saved us. Remember how excited and how zealous and how on fire for God you were when God set you free from sin, when God set you free from your old life of sin, when God took you out of darkness and placed you into His marvelous light. All you wanted to know about was Jesus. All you wanted to talk about was Jesus. All you wanted to do was praise Jesus and thank Jesus and worship. All you wanted to know about was Jesus and what He did for you at Calvary's cross. You couldn't understand. You couldn't grasp your mind around the love that somebody could have to give their life as a ransom for your soul. You couldn't grasp your mind. You were so excited that you were set free from captivity and bondage. And you were so excited to do the work of the Lord. You were so excited to do that which God was asking you to do. You were so excited to learn this gospel of Jesus Christ. I know I was. But somewhere along the way, we get sidetracked. Somewhere along the way, we get off course and we get off track. Whether it's because of our own unbelief or because of fear of outward opposition, because Satan is coming to oppose you.
Yes, he will.
Whether you realize it or not, you have an adversary. There is an adversary of your soul who is as a roaming lion, and he roams seeking whom he may devour. And he's not worried about your houses. He's not worried about your cars and your finances. What he wants from you is your faith. He wants the foundation of your faith to be moved. He wants the foundation of your faith to be... He wants you to walk away from the foundation of your faith. And if he can get you to walk away from that very thing which allows you, which provides you with the presence and the power of God, if he can get you away from that, then he can get you into, he can get you doing, he can get you believing anything. Because it's that foundation of our faith that provides us with the presence of Almighty God. That aids us with the power of God that we need to do what God has called us to do, but more importantly, to be whom God has called us to be. God is building a temple. He's building a temple with your life. That's what the Holy Spirit is trying to do with you. He's trying to take your life and make it something that His Spirit and His power can inhabit and flow through freely as He desires to do. Paul said that we are temples of the Holy Spirit. He said, "Know ye not that you are a temple of the Holy Spirit, that you are a dwelling place of the power of God. You are a dwelling place of the very presence of Almighty God. You are a dwelling place of the person of the Holy Spirit." And He's desiring to build a temple of you and I. He's desiring to do a work in you and I that we cannot do for ourselves. And I know many times we can get sidetracked and think, well, I'm not doing this good enough, or I'll never be good enough because I'll never be what they were. I'll never look like they looked, or I'll never sound like they sounded, or I'll never this, that, and the other. While God the Holy Spirit is saying, forget all of that. Forget all of it. Just give me what you got.
Amen.
Just give me what you got. Come back to the foundation and I'll do for you what you can't even imagine or fathom. I'll do it for you. Don't worry about the gold and the silver. Don't worry. Just present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Yes.
Our reasonable service is simply to present ourselves, to present our bodies, to present our souls to God, to do with us as He pleases. But the only way that He can do with us as He pleases is if our faith remains solely in Jesus Christ and what He's done for us at the cross. I know so many times we can get so focused on so many other aspects of our life and ministry that we can forget just the simplicity of the gospel. Just the simplicity that I can do nothing without the aid, without the help, without the unction, without the power of the Holy Spirit moving and operating and flowing in my heart and in my life. And the only thing that provides me with that power, the only thing that provides me with that aid, is if my faith is still in Christ and what He's done at the cross, that I still have not been moved from the foundation of my faith. In Revelation chapter 3, John the Revelator, he would say, the Lord would say that you're doing all these good works. You're busy. You're doing all these good things, doing good works in my name. But I have one thing against you, and that's that you have left your first love. And if you've left your first love, it does not matter what else you do. All of it is going to be counted as dung if your heart is not where it is supposed to be. If you're not building upon the foundation of your faith, if you're not building upon the foundation that has already been laid. So God addresses the issues. He addresses their complacency by telling them to go and to get wood from the mountain. Don't worry about the other things. Just go and get wood, and I'll build a temple. And I, he said here in Haggai 1, that I will be glorified. Here in verse 8, he said, go and get wood from the mountain, and I'll be glorified in that simple thing. And for their fear of outward opposition, their fear of outward enemies, their fear of failure and everything else, there was so much fear that had gripped their hearts. Outward opposition had diluted their minds. But for their fear, he raises up the prophet Zechariah. And he encourages them. And he tells them that it's not by might, nor by power, but it's by my Spirit, saith the Lord, that this temple is going to be accomplished. You tell the devil, devil, it doesn't matter. It's not about my ability anyway. It's not about how good I can do in any way. What God is trying to do in me, it's not going to be accomplished by my power, by my ingenuity, by my ability. It's going to be accomplished by the power of the Holy Spirit working and moving in my heart and in my life. That was the encouragement that God sent through the prophet Zechariah for them to continue to do the work of the Lord, to continue to build the house of the Lord. Don't worry that you don't have the manpower that you need. Don't worry that you don't have what they used to. Don't worry about all that. Just know this, That if you'll come back to the foundation, if you'll just provide me a willing vessel upon the foundation that has already been laid, then I will accompany you with my spirit to do the work despite the opposition, despite the failure, despite the fear, despite all of that. If you'll just provide me with the faith that is needed, I'll do in you what I desire to do. It's not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts.
Amen.
It's not about your strength and about your ability anyhow.
Amen.
I know how the devil can condemn. I know how the devil can get us all riled up and get us focused on our own failures and our own inconsistencies and our own power that we don't have. I know that feeling. I know that feeling. I understand that. But the word to us today is still the word that was to Israel to complete the work of the Lord. That what God desires to do in each and every one of us, it's not going to be accomplished by us or our power or our ability, but it's going to be accomplished. It will be accomplished. If I'll just stay true to the foundation of my faith, Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross, if I'll stay true to that, the work that God wants to do in me shall be accomplished.
Amen.
Because it's not by my might, it's not by my power, but it's by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts.
Yes.
God raised up Zechariah. And Zechariah began to prophesy this. And Zechariah said, O mountain, who are you? O great mountain, who are you that stands before Zerubbabel? Before Zerubbabel, O great mountain, you shall become a plain. So the great mountain of hindrance, the great mountain of fear and opposition that stood against Israel, Zechariah prophesied that it would become a plain. Not because of their power or their ability, but because the Spirit of the Lord was about to accompany them in a way that it never had before. Why? Because of their goodness? No. But because they made the decision, because they heeded the word of the Lord, and they came back to the foundation of the house of the Lord. I'm here to tell you that if you will make the decision, you will make the declaration that you're coming back to the foundation of your faith, I'm telling you the power of the Holy Ghost will accompany you to do and to be whatever God has called you to do and whatever God has called you to be.
Amen.
And when you return, when you know that you know, when you know that you know that you've returned to the foundation of your faith, you can stand up like Zechariah and you can shout to that mountain, grace, grace, before me, mountain, you're going to become a plain. You're not going to hinder what God's doing. You're not going to stop what God's doing, because it's not going to be by my power anyway. The weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The weapons that you and I have are not carnal, physical weapons anyhow. The weapons that you and I have are God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And I don't know about you, but that's enough for me.
Amen.
That's the power that you and I have been provided. If we will simply make the decision. And at times I know it's easy for us. And I'm not saying you go to bed one night with your faith where it ought to be, with your focus, with your heart where it ought to be, and you wake up the next morning and it's gone. I'm not saying that. That's foolishness. It doesn't happen like that. But I am saying, I know from personal experience that we can get so focused on everything else in our lives, we can get so concerned and so bogged down with the cares of this life, like Jesus talked about. We can get so focused on these temporal things, and even on good, godly things, we can get so focused on that slowly but surely we get moved from what really matters. From our first love. We get moved, whether it's because of outward opposition or our own complacency, our own unbelief, whatever it is. I know how easy it is. It can happen.
Amen.
But the Lord tells us, He encourages us, He instructs us. He doesn't just leave us where we are. He gives us an opportunity to come back and to come back and to come back time and time again. So he addresses their fear by saying, don't worry about it. It doesn't need to be accomplished by your power and your ability anyway. I'm going to send my spirit to do what it needs to do in order for this temple to be accomplished. And then for their unbelief, he tells them, because the unbelief in their hearts thinking, this will never be what it used to be. This will never be like Solomon's temple. And I know a lot of times we can get in that same place in our own hearts and in our own lives. God, my relationship with you will never be what it ought to be. It'll never be what it used to be. I'll never be as excited and as on fire. But let me tell you something. What is ahead is so much greater. If God spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us while we were sinners, how much more will he do for us now that we are his children? Amen. He encourages them by telling them that the glory of the latter house shall be greater than that of the former. Not because it looks better, not because of this and that and everything else, but because you simply return to the foundation of your faith. You simply provided me with what you... I'm not worried about the outward circumstances. I'm not worried about what it looks like on the outward. If you'll just provide me with a place for my presence and my power to dwell, then I'll do for you what you can't do for yourself. I'll do a work in you. I'll help you, I'll bless you, I'll strengthen you. And the glory of the latter house shall be greater than that of the former. And we know this was really speaking of what was to come a few hundred years later, but the encouragement was still the same. And it holds true for us today. That if we've walked away, we must consider our ways. We must consider, Lord, am I doing what you've called me to do? More importantly, am I believing what you're asking me to believe? Because, Lord, I don't want to be deceived. I don't want to be swept away by fear, by unbelief, or by complacency. I don't want to. I know that's a desire that in every one of our hearts, Lord, don't let me stray away. Don't let me be deceived. Lord, don't let me be moved from the foundation. And, Lord, if I am moved, Lord, send a prophet. Send a prophet to rebuke me. Lord, send your spirit to convict me, to show me that I've moved, to show me that I've removed myself from the place that you would have me to be. And not just as it regards our faith, but as it regards our everyday life and living. Lord, if I've taken a step outside of your will, if I'm doing something that's not, Lord, show me. Lord, convict. That's what's great today about the work of the Holy Spirit. The work of the Spirit that's been provided to you and I under the new covenant. Is thank God we don't have to have a prophet in public stand up and expose all of our sins and tell us what we're doing wrong and everything else. We have the person of the Holy Spirit residing on the inside of us. We have the person of the Holy Spirit there to convict us, to show us when we take a wrong way, to show us when we've moved off track, to show us when we begin to lean off the foundation of our faith. We have the person of the Holy Spirit to convict us, not to condemn us. Condemnation tells us we're wrong and leaves us there. But conviction tells us we're wrong, but there's an answer.
Amen.
You're wrong. You're messed up. You've done some things wrong. You've left the foundation. But if you'll return to me, if you'll come back, then I'll accept you and we'll have fellowship again. And I can do in your life what I desire to do. This, I know it was kind of short, and this wasn't a message of rebuke, but I feel more of a message of encouragement. I believe to much of the church, this message is a message of rebuke. Because much of the church has done exactly that. We've walked away from the foundation. We've walked away from the sacrifice. We've ceased to do the work of the Lord in the time and hour in the earth today. The time and hour in which we are living. We've ceased to do it. Because we've left the foundation of our faith. Looking for outward things more than we're looking for the one who can provide a change in our hearts and in our lives. As to much of the church, I believe it is a rebuke. But to us today, maybe it is a rebuke to you tonight. I don't know. But I think more so it's an encouragement. Lord, don't let me grow complacent. Lord, don't let me be hindered by unbelief. And Lord, don't let me be affected by fear because of outward opposition, because of the enemy, because of this, that, and everything else that I have to go through in my everyday life and living. Lord, no matter what, no matter all this opposition and all these things I'm facing, Lord, don't let me be removed from the foundation of my faith. I know it's a simple message. I know it's not deep theological stuff. But I felt just a word of exhortation, a word of encouragement upon my heart. Because I'm watching, I'm seeing, I feel, I sense. The past couple of days, I just, out of nowhere, I'll just begin to weep. And I'll begin to cry and say, God, this thing is real. People are really being deceived. People who once were truly on a right track are now believing a lie. They're now holding the truth and unrighteousness. They've now walked away from the foundation of their faith. They're being deceived. Not only are they deceiving, but they themselves are being deceived by the evil one. And the question that Satan asked in the garden is the question that still he asks today. Hath God truly said? And I know, let me tell you something, when you're walking in the truth, it doesn't absolve you from the affairs of this life, and it doesn't absolve you from the attack of the enemy. If it's true, those of us who truly are believing the truth of this gospel, those who are walking according to the foundation of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, the attack is on you even greater. The attack, the fear will try to come even greater because that is who Satan is after. He's after those who have grabbed a hold of this thing, those who are duly, truly doing the work of the Lord. Because only those who are believing this message of Christ and Him crucified, only those who understand from where the power of God comes, how the power of God is supplied, how the help of God is supplied in their everyday life, only those who understand and believe that can truly affect a change in this earth today. Because I believe it. I remember when I said this morning in John's church, but I remember when I first started listening to Brother Swagger, and I would hear him say over and over again, he would say, and he still says it, that what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church is to come back to your first love. Come back to the cross. And he would say it over and over and over again. And sometimes I would sit there and I said this morning in John's church, but I would sit there and say, well, I wouldn't disagree with him, but I said, well, you know, there's other things, you know, so on. But what really matters in this time and hour in which we're living is a people who know in whom they have believed, is a people who know what they believe. Paul told Timothy, I preached this morning, hold fast to the form of doctrine that was first delivered to you. Amen. If you don't know anything else, just know the foundation of what you believe. If you forget everything else, if everything in your life gets chaotic and gets busy and you don't, just know in whom you have believed. Because if God can work through that to save you as a sinner, then He can work through it now to change you as a saint. So He's not asking us to present Him with something great and something faultless. He's asking us to present Him with what we've got. Go get wood from the mountain. Present to God what you have. Come back to the foundation. And like the Lord told Israel through Haggai, and if you'll just present that to me, I will be glorified, saith the Lord of hosts. There was only one man whom God ever spoke from heaven and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased, and that was Jesus. And the only way that you and I can truly bring glory to God, the only way that we can truly be pleasing to God, is if we are found in Jesus Christ, if we are found believing the right way, if we are found trusting the foundation that brought us in, that it's the same thing that will bring us through. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand to our feet tonight. Thank you. I know this was very simple and I didn't really preach it like I wanted to
preach
it.
Good message, brother. Thank you, Jesus.
But I just thank the Lord for what He's doing in the church.
We live in a very serious time and a very serious hour, whether you realize it or not. The coming of the Lord is nigh. We better get our houses in order. And I'm not talking about our physical houses. I'm talking about this house. Talking about this dwelling place, this temple, this tabernacle. We better get it in order. Because God didn't want to just save us and just lay a foundation in our hearts. And He wants to preserve us. He didn't want to just save us and leave us where we are, but He wants to preserve us, the Bible says, blameless unto the coming of the Lord. Does that mean we're perfect? No. But it does mean that we're mature. It does mean that we are not tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine that comes our way. It does mean that we know what we believe. It does mean that we recognize and we realize that if it not for Christ and what He's done at the cross, amen, then not only could I not be saved, but I can't presently be kept. And I can't presently, ultimately, I can't see the Lord of glory face to face as I desire to see Him. We live in a very serious time, and Satan is ever trying to pull us away from the foundation of our faith. But my prayer for myself and my prayer for the church, those who believe this message, is that we would say, God, don't let us be removed from the foundation.
Yes.
Because when we leave the foundation of our faith, whether we know it or not, whether we believe it or not, we'll find ourselves under a curse. We'll find ourselves without the aid, without the help, without the power of the Holy Spirit. So my prayer for those of us who believe this message of the cross, those of us who believe that it's the only answer, it's the only way of victory in our hearts and lives, is that our prayer would be, God, don't let us be moved. Because I'm watching it with my own eye. People being deceived. People walking away from the foundation of their faith. And like Romans 1 and 2 teaches us, that the more you reject the truth, the more you reject this foundation of Christ and Him crucified, the more darkness that will come in. The more darkness that will come in and invade your life. Light rejected is darkness accepted. So my prayer for those of us who believe it is, Lord, don't let us be moved. And my prayer for those who don't know it is, God, open their eyes. God, convict them by the power of Your Holy Spirit, that they would consider their ways. I'm telling you, it's time for us not to boast of what we know and that we know more than people and that we this. It's time for our hearts to be broken for the church, because the church is in a mess. The prophet Joel said that it's time for the ministers of the Lord to weep between the porch and the altar. It's time for us, Lord, we repent of going a false way. God, as a church, we repent of leaving the foundation of our faith. God, as a people, we repent of our transgression. We repent of our sin, God. We repent of leaving the foundation of the Lord. And God, some kind of way, bring a remnant. And it won't be many, but there will be a remnant who return to the foundation of their faith. And the glory of the latter house, what we're about to see in this earth, is going to be greater. I'm telling you, God has told me this, that the move of God we're about to see in this earth is going to be greater than anything that has ever taken place in this world. I'm telling you, God has told me that. The glory of the latter house shall be greater than that of the former. And it's not because we're special or because we're anything, but it's because God is calling a remnant of believers back to the foundation of Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross. And the temple that God has been building in the body of Christ for some 2,000 years, the capstone is about to be laid. And you and I are part of that capstone. And the capstone, without a house underneath it and a house without a foundation underneath it, is nothing. In order to have a house that stands, you have to have a firm foundation. And in order to have a capstone that finishes the building, you have to have a house that has been firmly built upon the foundation. I'm telling you, we're about to see something that this world has never seen before. I prophesy to you, we are about to see something this world has never seen before. But I also tell you that Satan is at work like never before. And if there was ever a time that we're to be sober, that we're to be vigilant, it's right now. Because Satan is roaming around even now. And he will come to you. And you as an individual are responsible for your own salvation. You as an individual are responsible yourself for what you believe. And there will come the time when you will have to make the decision to either totally believe the lie or totally believe the truth. The choice is ours. The choice is mine. The choice is yours. As an individual, the minister can't make it for us. Church can't make it for us. We're going to have to make that decision. Lord, will we stay true to the foundation of our faith and experience this great move of God that's about to take place? Or will we walk away and live our lives, the rest of our lives, under a delusion and under a curse? Because that's what happens when we